Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Which stands one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Bill. This time, we'll call the second meeting of April 2013 to order. Welcome to all of you who are with us tonight. The first order of business is to have our public comments. We have public comments available at the beginning of each meeting. Everyone can talk up to 3 minutes on the subject of their choice. Tonight we welcome Ms. Grace Baldwin, who would like to talk about needing police help. Ms. Baldwin, please come forward. Welcome to you.
Thank you. I would like to speak on the police help. About 2 weeks ago, we had a high-speed chase down in Greenway Park. And it was serious to me because my grandkids were on the way home, and I did call out to them on 85 to tell them not to come into Greenway Park. It went on, I'll say, a good, almost an hour, and it was unsafe. And I felt that something was wrong, something serious was wrong, because I never seen that done before in a residential area. And that's just one of the things I want to talk about, and it's our police officers in schools. We have a lot of bullies, we have a lot of drug trafficking coming into the schools by the students. And I feel that we need to address all of that. Also, I'd say about 4 or 5 years ago, I called the National Guard because I could see a lot of things. If I'm seeing it, people know, people just afraid to tell. So I called them to see what they could do, because you know, back in the 60s, we had the Army Guards out patrolling, and they cleared up our community. So I heard today that we do have a need, and I'm saying it would be good if we could call on the Army Guards to help out until we can get things cleared up here. These gangs are serious. They're not playing. They got their stuff together, so police officers need to get their stuff, get their act together. Things are not getting better, it's getting worse. And that's all I have to say. And thank you for having me.
Thank you.
Thank you,
Ms. Baldwin. Commissioners, at this time, I'd like to ask us to review the agenda. Mr. Honeycutt, do you have any changes to the agenda from what we have presented to us here?
No, sir. There was a request today to talk about present use, and if you're okay with that, I'll do that under county manager's report.
Okay. The item 10.
Yes, sir.
Review the agenda, also items on the consent agenda. Are there any items on the consent agenda that any board member would like to have removed? Hearing none, is there a motion to approve the agenda, which would include the consent agenda items?
So moved.
Thank you, Linda. Is there a second? Bill? Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. Agenda item number 6 is the annual Workforce Investment Act report from 2011-2012. Pleased to introduce and welcome Ms. Cheryl Ray, who is our Workforce Development Board representative, who will go over this year's report. Cheryl, welcome to you. Yeah,
thank you. Good evening. Thanks for having me. I'm one of your representative from the county. We have a full slate for Alamance County now. So AC's representing, the Division of Vocational Rehab is representing, and also the Chamber's representing Alamance County on the Regional Partnership Board. So I'm going to take my 3 minutes. I'm going to keep up with the public forum and just say thank you for allowing me to be here. As a reminder, our Regional Partnership Board is made up of 5 counties. So we are joined together with Orange County, Randolph County, Montgomery, and Moore.
Cheryl, you're not limited to 3 minutes.
Oh, I want 3 minutes, okay. Tom. I don't want any more than 3 minutes. I am good with that. The vision for the board is to be recognized as the catalyst between individuals' education, training, and employers' needs through effective utilization of available resources. And I think we dropped off 2 weeks ago. I think you all have them. The glossy finish for the annual report. So you'll see all 5 counties represented in here. With our chair's report, you will see some highlight stories, success stories, especially with the WIA grant money, so the Workforce Investment Act money. So this is kind of the money comes down from the federal government. It gets kind of consolidated down through the counties, and then as a representative from the county and through the Regional Partnership Board, we allocate to those that bid and represent our county. So JobLink is one of those, Building Futures is one of those, that gets federal dollars and then spends them here within our county on our citizens. So you'll see some of the stories there. The meetings are every other month now, and I hear every other month great stories about our citizens here that are going to ACC, that are in the youth program. So definitely a lot of success stories. So certainly you all are invited to attend those. We actually meet in Asheboro. I think Ms. Massey has been to some of those. So Commissioner Massey, you'll see in the center of the report the dollars, so roughly $730,000 for Alamance County allocated by program down, and that was last year. So we'll see what money we get this year to allocate. Those have not been placed yet for our county. The main kind of highlight in your book, you'll see that Staff Mark, they actually received like the big award this year for Alamance County. They worked with the Employment Security Office here in Burlington and placed over 200 folks from our county into jobs here in our county. So that's really a great thing to have. So we're excited about that. Looking forward to 2013-2014 year, we have two things. We joined with Triad Works, which is a division, we've always been a member, a division of 5 workforce boards, so it represents 14 counties here in North Carolina, and we did a strategic plan for 5 years, and the 4 goals on that strategic plan were: number 1, impact, so maximizing the workforce development system to provide a skilled workforce to improve quality of life and create opportunities for our Triad Works region. Partnership and collaboration, which is what I'm definitely a proponent for. Foster collaboration and build relationship with committed partners, stakeholders to strive common goals and become a catalyst for change. And then number 3, systems capacity, enhance the quality of workforce development delivery systems to become the go-to place for responsiveness and solutions for the customer's needs, so our workforce needs. And then number 4, communication and marketing. So develop a multifaceted plan of communication connecting communities and their stakeholders to workforce development services and resources. So those are a couple of things that we found going through this. People didn't know that these funds are there, ready to assist them if they would just come and apply for them or come and work with the ESC or the JobLink office. And so with that, strategic plan in place, the Department of Commerce is already, they're kind of like our guiding body as well. They have already put in place a revamp of what we consider the one-stop centers. So we consider those JobLink here in North Carolina. So those will actually be redone kind of across the whole scope. So whether if an ESC office is operating it or a community college is operating it, or someone else that bidding on the contract, they will all look the same. The processes will be the same in the side. They'll all be marketed the same, so we can start branding across the state. So no matter if you're in Alamance County or you're in Carteret County, you're going to get the same show when you go into the ESC office or JobLink office. Here in this county, it's JobLink. So that's really all I have to say unless there's any questions.
I don't get your emails anymore.
Well, I will send it to Linda Parker.
Okay.
She's actually retiring, so there'll be a new person. So we'll get you on that list again. All right. Thank you, this evening.
Thank you, Cheryl. Any questions for Cheryl? Thank you very much. Item 7 on the agenda continues a recently started initiative where we hear from different departments within the county, different groups that we're involved in. Tonight we're going to hear from the Department of Environmental Health, and we would like to invite Carl Carroll to the stand. You're already here.
Good evening. Carol, remember what Cheryl said.
3 minutes. I want to thank you for inviting me here tonight to talk about environmental health. I don't know if it's a good thing or a bad thing to be first, with this department spotlight, but hopefully it's a good thing. I've been working in public health for about 27 years. I've been working in Alamance County for 23 years, 7 months, and 15 days.
Sounds like he's going to retire.
Not that you're counting.
That's what I'm thinking. Is it that bad, Carl?
No, sir. It's been a very, it's been a pleasure. And don't plan on retiring anytime soon.
Good.
So first I want to start by asking you some questions. Do you drink water? Have you ever had a problem with mosquitoes? Does your child attend child care, or your grandchild attend child care? Do you eat in restaurants? Do you ever go swimming in a public swimming pool?
No.
Have you ever stayed in a hotel? Are you thinking about getting a tattoo?
There you go.
That's right. That got me.
Do your neighbors dispose of their trash properly? If you answered yes to any of these questions, then environmental health has personally affected you and touched your life. You see our mission here, but our goal in environmental health is to provide the best environmental health services that we can with the resources that you've entrusted to us. I'm going to talk about these specific programs and provide a few statistics about environmental health here in Alamance County. And it'll take me about 10 minutes. First, I'd like to talk about water quality. Our staff spends about 3,000 man hours each year, or about 10% of their time, working to protect our private water supplies in Alamance County. We visit sites for all new wells to make evaluations to see where the well should be located. We issue permits for the wells. After the wells are drilled, the contractor calls us. We go out to make sure the well is put in the correct location and that the contractor drilled the well properly. Then after the pump's installed, electricity's turned on, we go back out and collect water samples after the well's been disinfected to be sure that the water is okay for the folks to drink. Our on-site wastewater program, our staff spends about 3,000 man hours each year, or about 10% of their time working in this area. I'm sorry, about 30% of their time working in this area. We evaluate sites for septic systems. We actually have to turn down about 17% of the sites that we evaluate. We permit these systems, inspect them. Then some systems have to be monitored on a yearly basis to make sure that they're functioning properly. About 650 man hours are spent each year working to prevent rabies. We work closely with the Sheriff's Department, the Burlington Police Department, other animal control agencies in the county, veterinarians, the state public health vet, and medical professionals to prevent rabies in the county. Since 1997, 125 cases of rabies in animals have been documented in Alamance County, but no human cases. There hasn't been a case of rabies in a human in Alamance County since the 1950s. We have a clinic set up this on April the 27th on Saturday at our office from 9 to 1 to vaccinate dogs and cats for $5. Staff spend over 10,000 man hours, or 33% of their time, carrying out food, lodging, institutional, public swimming pool, and tattoo programs in the county. The state approved some needed changes recently, and we're in the process of implementing those new rules with all the facilities in the county. I have here a list of all the different types of facilities that we inspect in the county, with the numbers of those types of facilities. Some of these facilities we inspect 4 times a year, Some are only inspected once a year. But last year we did 2,310 inspections of these facilities. When our staff conducts these food and lodging facilities inspections, they focus on the food and the employees. Specifically, they look at personal hygiene, cleaning and sanitizing, how the food is prepared and cooked. They verify the food is from an approved source, and they make sure that it's held at the proper temperatures. Establishments are reviewed and recommendations are provided to the managers in writing, and then a score is posted. Public health preparedness focuses us on planning for and responses to infectious disease outbreaks, natural disasters, biological, chemical, and radiological incidents. We work with a wide range of community partners to meet our target capabilities in areas such as surveillance and investigation, emergency public information, community preparedness, and volunteer management. Each year, we must demonstrate our capabilities for mass countermeasure, distribution, and dispensing from the Strategic National Stockpile. Staff recruit, prepare, and connect with private businesses, our towns and cities, and other agencies to establish mechanisms and to identify locations so that if we need to dispense massive amounts of countermeasures to the entire population of Alamance County, that enormous task can be accomplished. We have one person that spends about 50 to 60% of her time doing this work. We receive and respond to complaints and inquiries about bed bugs, mosquitoes, ticks, rodents, and other aggravating things so that the citizens of Alamance County can enjoy Alamance County and prevent the spread of disease. We receive illegal solid waste disposal complaints daily. These images are examples of what some residents are disposing of in their own backyards. If solid waste disposal was not regulated, this could lead to groundwater contamination, mosquito breeding, fire hazards, and serious injuries. We maintain information on our website about how to report these issues. Many children and adults in Alamance County suffer from asthma and other health issues related to air quality and asthma triggers. In 2007, Environmental Health worked with the Healthy Alamance Asthma Coalition to implement an air quality flag program. A specific color flag is flown daily at all the schools, some businesses, and county buildings to indicate the air quality for the day. It's based on a scale you see here on the right. This helps citizens that are sensitive to these air quality issues appropriately plan their daily activities. Additionally, Environmental Health provides indoor air quality consultations through referrals from physicians and other medical professionals. This is a proven program that's designed to reduce asthma episodes by identifying triggers in the home. Unfortunately, lead poisoning is still an issue that we must continue to work on. We receive notification when a child has been lead poisoned, and our staff contacts the parents, and we visit the home and other places where the child spends a lot of their time. Lots of questions are asked, painted surfaces and other items are examined and sometimes tested. A report is written, and if abatement of a hazard is required, staff follow up to make sure the abatement is completed as required. Staff spend about 6,000 man hours or 21% of their time working in the air quality, lead, solid waste, and vector control programs. If you hadn't already done so, please visit our webpage on the county's website. Applications, instructions, and additional resources are available there to all residents, and they can also check the score of their favorite restaurant. Including me, we have 18 staff members in environmental health. Our most junior staff person has been with us 6.5 years. We have staff available 10.5 hours a day, Monday through Friday. And quite often you'll see staff on the weekend at special events inspecting food facilities. We have a number of quality assurance processes in place, including formal surveys of our clients. And we're proud of the fact that over the past 10 years, those surveys reveal that customers are very pleased with the service that we provide. But when we receive a suggestion, we examine those suggestions to determine if we need to improve that service and if it's feasible. In fact, tomorrow night at the Board of Health meeting, I'll be presenting several proposed changes to our local Board of Health rules at a public hearing. The proposed changes came from suggestions that a customer had discussed with staff. We're proud of our commitment to try and improve our services each day. In order to do so, we track those activities extensively. Shown here is some of the data from a variety of our programs over a 5-year period. Capturing and monitoring this data allows us to make adjustments to our most valuable resource, our staff. And we try to allocate these resources effectively and efficiently across all the different programs. Overall, environmental health is ready for whatever may challenge the public health of our county next. And that is in spite of the supervision. Seriously, I can tell you, because of the dedication of our staff, that work and the work that we do, we're meeting our goal of providing excellent environmental health services to the citizens of Alamance County. Thank you.
Carl, thank you. Questions? Carl, comments? So much of what you do, we take for granted because it doesn't come to the surface. It's not a problem. Certainly, that's because of the work of you and your staff. So.
Well, I appreciate being able to come tonight and talk to you about that.
Carl.
Yes, ma'am.
How much, being a real estate agent, I deal with the lead poisoning as well. You know, we have to put a paper out there saying it could have, prior to 78. So how many kids have had lead poisoning in recent years or in Alamance County? Do you know that?
Last year, we did, I think it was eight or ten investigations about lead poisoning.
Did they mostly come from older homes?
Most of it comes from lead paint from older homes, but we have had at least one or two cases where a family member was working in a occupation where they were exposed to lead, and it was on their clothing, and they were bringing that home, and the child was getting exposed that way, but by just talking with them and the employer and them removing those clothes at the work site, we were able to reduce that exposure to the child.
Okay, because that's a serious thing. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Does all the employees at environmental health, do they do every, all of them do the same different things, or you got them assigned to different areas?
We have them assigned to different areas, but we've done a lot of cross-training the staff because, as things change, sometimes program areas we have expansion or the need for more folks to work in that area. So we keep people cross-trained so that we can kind of ramp up in one area if we need to.
Okay, good.
What do you see as the biggest threat environmentally? Is there one?
I think the thing that we have to be careful with is if the economy ramps back up, that we're able to maintain our staff so that we can meet the needs of the public. Because just 10, 15 years ago, things were booming so much that we had some real issues trying to keep up with all the demands. Because, you know, Ms. Massey, you can probably think about this, that if folks want to build a new home, the contractor's ready to build, and if we're 6 weeks behind on doing site evaluation, mm-hmm. we get a lot of pressure to move fast, and that's when you start moving too fast, that's when problems start occurring.
I agree. I know what you're talking about.
What do you have? We were asking our soil people or whatever at our Farm Bureau. I don't know if we asked them directly, but I talked to him after the meeting. What do we have that you can show us about the trend of land that were perk or not perk in our county?
There's a soil survey going on right now through soil conservation.
Yeah, what we were talking about.
And that can give folks a good idea of where the better soils are, but they don't do the extensive examination as is needed to site a septic system. But we rely even now on those old maps from 1956. If we get in an area and we're having trouble finding a site for a septic system, we'll refer back to those old maps to try to see if there's an area that we might need to try to find a site for a septic system. So.
Big Davidson County, aren't they countywide water?
Are you familiar? Pretty much county.
Did they get some grant money a long time ago to push for that? Mm-hmm. What's our potential for that, do you know?
At this day and time, I don't think it's a very good chance that we would get that.
Never know, you try, but just I'm curious as to what's available.
Right.
I mean, right. I understood that they got countywide water a long time ago because of grant money, and so everybody here wants water out in the county. But you know, it's political. Water in this county is very political, and it should be. It should be infrastructure that's readily available if it can be deemed financially advantageous to do it. But take the politics out of it. We got to get the politics out of water somehow. Yeah. And I don't know how we do it. How you do it?
Well, one of the things in the future you probably need to look at is what is our groundwater resource in the county? What's the potential? What's its limitations? A few years ago when we had a drought over in the area, kind of Robin Hood Road area, yeah. That was developed a long time ago, and then 10 years ago it started booming again. You had a lot of shallow wells that went dry, and we don't really know what the groundwater capacity is in certain areas of the county. So we probably in the future need to look at what's the capacity of a certain area, and is the development restrictions that we have, if we're going to take the water out of the ground in private wells, is there the lot size, is it going to cause a problem with folks in those areas, their wells going dry? So.
Carl, that happened on in the Hall River Hope Neal Road too, mm-hmm. When Burlington had to run water out there because of the contamination. that place on the corner there that had the fuel tank and the gas tanks and everything. So that did happen there, and they had to run it from Burlington all the way down from, that was a long way, and actually they met Hall River. Hall River met them at the church up there, and we gave them water from there on up, so.
Last question I'd like to ask. Do you work then closely with Greg on some of these dishwashers and things that you find in the back of the lawn, or is that totally separate?
We just tried to get it cleaned up. We explain to them what they need to do to get it cleaned up, and then we refer them to Greg.
As an option.
Yes.
is an option, yeah.
Because we had, and you talked to us about illegally dumping tires and
right, all right, that's primarily something that we've worked really close together.
Are we still having a problem with that?
Not of late, no, sir. It's been quiet, knock on wood.
Yeah, now that we're telling everybody about it again, right?
But we were glad to get that cleaned up and resolved.
Good. Carl, thank you very much for the presentation.
Mr. Chairman, I do want to thank Carl and his staff for the work that they do, and okay. And it is very. That's one of the reasons why we wanted to do this focus on departments, but and really focus on some of the unsung work that we as a county do, and a lot of it is done through environmental health, but we really do appreciate you and everything that you do, so thank you.
Thank you. You want me to stay? Because I told Barry I would do the next item.
Yes. I was wondering if he was from the health department, speaking of which. So, yes, the next item on the agenda is a budget amendment from the health department. So, please do.
I think you have information about this request for the budget amendment. We are available to receive $18,824 from North Carolina Department of Public Health. For food and lodging funds. They're entirely state funds, and we'd like to use these funds to purchase a vehicle. Unfortunately, we had a vehicle damaged in an accident a few weeks ago. Thank goodness nobody was hurt seriously, but we are requesting to use this money to purchase a vehicle.
Questions for Carl? Is there a motion to approve this amendment? Thank you, Bill. Linda, second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? It's easy enough.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That's correct.
Next item on the agenda is an update on the Alamance-Guilford County line discussion and proposed resolution. I'd like to start this conversation, but turn it over to Craig and or Clyde about the resolution itself. You may recall we've been talking about this and talking about whether or not we should meet and not meet with the folks from Guilford. Bill Ashley and I attended a meeting at the request of the Guilford County Chair and Vice Chair probably about 5 weeks ago. And in attendance were the two of us, their chair, vice chair, their county attorney, and their interim county manager. And we just basically went over there and said, look, we've had issues with this for a long time. We have several specific situations and examples of folks getting their tax bills from both counties and not knowing which one to pay. And of course, they shared the same experience based on the fact they had had complaints as well. We both said, you know, we're willing to go back to our board and recommend, frankly, whatever you want to do. And we outlined the straight line and basically said that at that time we knew we had at least one commissioner in Alamance that was only going to support the geodetic straight line. And then we also outlined in layman's terms what we had understood about our approach for addressing the Orange County situation. And they thought about it and they contacted us again and invited us to come to their work session, bringing our county manager, assistant manager, attorney, and also our GIS expert, and all of whom went over for a work session one afternoon and spent, about an hour? Going over both approaches. And again, stressing that whatever they decide, we're willing to come back to this board and recommend because we feel like we need closure on the subject. And we at no time recommended one approach over the other. They were familiar, and Mark Payne, their attorney, was familiar with the geodetic line approach and the fact that their board had recommended the geodetic line approach to defining the line. And all this happened because, Clyde, it was 2007, a new satellite was put up there and redefined the lines so we could see for sure.
This board actually, together with the Guilford board, asked the geodetic survey folks to find the lines.
To define.
In Orange and in Guilford.
So that kind of led for the
latest rounds of discussion. So we talked about that, and then we asked Bruce to just briefly outline the approach that we had taken in Orange County and how the property owners there had some flexibility within a buffer zone to request how they could be in the county or which county they could be in, which he did a very good job. And we stayed around to answer any questions, which there were some, and they voted in their work session to go with the approach, we termed it the zigzag approach that we'd used in Orange County. Their board of commissioners totaled 9 individuals, and I believe
seven
were at the work session.
It's just 7 now.
No, it was 11. It came down to 9.
Right. Came down to 7.
Came down.
I believe that's right. Isn't that right? Yeah, they was just 7 now.
No, it's 9 now. It was 11. Yeah, it was 11. It came down to 9, but 7 of them were there.
Okay.
And with the 7 that were there voted to, as I said, go with the approach that we had taken on our discussions with Orange County. So with that in mind, Clyde then got with Mark Payne, his counterpart in Guilford, to come up with a resolution, which I'll let you explain. The other thing we did at that time was we asked Senator Gunn to hold a placeholder, I guess it's called, for local bills. So we got that in order. Assuming this board acts tonight, we can go ahead and move that process along. And let me ask you if you can explain it, or if you want to explain any other part of the resolution, and then we'll open it up for questions. All right. Among the commission.
Well, the purpose of this resolution establishes the procedure for requesting the General Assembly to change the location of the line. They've already got the geodetic survey line in place. And this resolution is similar to the one we did with Orange County. And it sets up a buffer of 150 feet and applies to property that has been historically taxed in the wrong county by the tax administrator. And this is a property that is adjoining the true geodetic line, or is within this 150-foot buffer. And Bruce has identified a number of properties that fit that criteria. The people that own these properties will be given the opportunity, if this resolution passes, to decide whether they want to stay in their historically taxed county or move into the appropriate county. And from that information, and depending on what they decide, they will have to pay for their own survey that will go around the 150-foot area tie that into the geodetic survey that's already existing. Having all that work done, we'll go back before the General Assembly next year in a second bill to get it finalized, to get the maps recorded. This first bill enables us to do this. The second bill finalizes. And that's the process we did in Orange, with the Orange Alamance line.
And just a couple of comments. One I left out. Also at this meeting was the mayor of Gibsonville, Lenny Williams, and he did plead with the Guilford board to provide some flexibility, if nothing else, he said, within the town limits of Gibsonville, and he had some very specific examples that he used. The other thing, Clyde, correct me if I'm wrong, but I know we have at least one homeowner that clearly is in Guilford County. He's outside the buffer zone, but he's been having the tax issues. Do we have to wait the full 2 years for his billing to be straightened out, or can we work with your counterparts in Guilford to where, okay, the ones that aren't in this buffer, we can go ahead and take care of?
I think once we get this resolution, if it passes tonight, and get the state legislation signed, then we can go ahead and make those adjustments, because then we'll have a process in place. The danger with doing that is if something derails it, then you have an uncomfortable position of voting to refund someone's taxes that shouldn't have been refunded. But I think we can work those issues out. There are not that many of them. There's that gentleman, and there's two others that I'm aware of.
And I don't understand why that's even an issue if they're clearly not in the buffer zone, but apparently it is.
Because the line hasn't been moved yet. It has
so even the straight line hadn't been moved.
Right. That's correct.
So we would move or start with moving the straight line and then work the buffer zone from that, and those properties that aren't in the buffer zone, we could go ahead and take care
of. This first bill just establishes the procedure for outlining where the new line will be. The old existing line is the line until the General Assembly changes it. And so that's the distinction.
And that would happen if this passes this year.
If this passes, the process will be in place. And we can go ahead and map it out and have a clear understanding of where the new line will be. And I think we can go ahead and make some adjustments. The second bill will go before the General Assembly next spring, about this time.
And who then identifies and notifies those property owners, both within the buffer zone, that this option may exist, and the ones that aren't in the buffer zone but are affected by this?
We did this by letter to the ones that I think in orange were historically taxed in the wrong county, and that narrowed the number down, and we sent a certified letter to them, Bruce? I can't recall.
Initially, we did not send certified letters, and I think we should. We worked with the tax departments and the GIS departments of both counties to make sure that we identified the current homeowner and make sure that they received the letters. At that time, because we hadn't come up with a methodology, there was more letters involved because it was a different process, so we had a huge buffer. You might be involved in this process. We had public hearings, those kind of things. But moving forward in this process, we would work with Guilford County's tax department, our tax department, and their GS department to make sure we have all those addresses and notify.
So we're not leaving anybody out.
Right. And, you know, at this point, when I did the initial numbers, if you remember, it was 72 homes involved. And so it's a much smaller number of letters and people involved than it was for Gordon County.
And I just, last thing I want to say about this, I want to reiterate, Tim, for your benefit, we adamantly did not recommend one procedure over the other.
I heard you. I'm going to comment on all that when we get time to talk.
Okay, we have time to talk.
All right. Define wrong county. In other words, you've said twice tonight that by whose standard are they in the wrong county?
Based on the geodetic survey that we now have.
Okay, geodetic.
Right. Okay. 2007, where they actually found the markers and put the line down, and we found people that have been historically taxed in the incorrect county for
by
years.
By geodetic.
Right, by this geodetic line. That's
correct. I support geodetic 100%. At what point did y'all know that all of their board was going to be able to be at that meeting?
They just had a meeting at a work session, and they said we were invited to that session, and they didn't know who would be there, but it would be, they was hoping it would be enough to make a decision.
But it's open to their whole board.
Right.
That was obvious.
Yeah.
And that was, see, the problem I have with the, I mean, I've been on the losing end of this debate all along, and I'm willing to accept defeat again on it. But I find it improper that we would go over there with representatives to where we wouldn't have a quorum or need to have a quorum nor advertise for a quorum to a meeting of theirs where a decision could definitely be made with Robert's Rules of Order quorum policies being met. I mean, to send two of us over there for to a meeting that it's obvious that they're going to be able to have all of their people there, and it's advertised. I just find that somewhat improper. At that point, I would have said, in my opinion, we all should have got together and talk. I mean, it's, I understand they had commissioners on that board. Now, am I wrong here? I've been told they had commissioners on that board that didn't even realize that this happened, that properties are split and houses are split and businesses are split. Was that true?
They seemed to be aware of what was going on.
I was told that there was, you know, some philosophy. Well, they didn't realize it happened.
I was amazed how up to snuff they were on what they did understand.
Well, I just, you know, it's my belief that to meet with them with in a capacity of knowing that they can have potentially their whole board there legally, and for us not to be able to have our whole board there to where we can have some good and real debate, I find it improper. And I certainly wouldn't have been a part of that. Now, if it was just going to be like the first meeting, didn't seem to be out of line, in my opinion, because that wasn't a quorum on their part, it wasn't a quorum on our part, right?
Right.
Okay, but this second one was a quorum on their part, but not on our part. And I just find that highly improper. That's the way I feel.
They chose to take that vote. We just went there to.
I realize that, but we should have known going in that vote could take place, and it did. Logistically, we should have known that, and logistically, all points of view should have been able to have been before at that thing. Now, I have read where, and Tom, I appreciate it, that you explicitly said we got one commissioner that's absolutely crazy on the idea of not going to anything but G-Daddy. I appreciate that.
When I said at least one, and I didn't use the word crazy.
When he told that, we were under the impression that they all were in favor of that G-Daddy line, and that's how
we kept saying from here, though, that they'd had a new board change, as if, you know, hopefully the philosophy would change because they'd had a new board change. So, I think when there's quorums met and there's policy going to be decided that both people involved or three, four, it could have been two bodies, three bodies, that quorums should have been met on both sides. That's the way I feel. That's the way I think government ought to be. To send a non-quorum group over there to basically lay out a point of view that you're going to support, by the way. A non-quorum group go over there to literally talk to a full, logistically met quorum group that can make a decision. I just think that's not the way I like to do government.
We went there with the intention of doing whatever they wanted to do. We just wanted to get it resolved. And what we went there with the fact is, knowing that they were in favor of that genetic line, and that's what we were going to agree to go along with. And they're the ones that changed their mind.
Well, you wouldn't have much of an option. But the point is,
that's true.
Is quorum to quorum is the way it should have been. That's my point.
I agree.
Well, you didn't do it.
Other discussion or questions?
Well, I wasn't happy about doing that because I agree with Tim on that. I mean, I really was. We didn't even know about it till after the fact. And I'm like, I think everybody should have went, and we were not invited.
I mean, there's a lot of things to just simply put out there. I mean, like I say, Guilford County's got a county line. It runs right through the Thomasville Bus Factory. Mr. Commissioners, Mrs. Commissioners, are you going to move the line around Thomasville Bus Factory now, huh? And I don't think they're smart enough over there, you commissioners, to know the full debate. I mean, did y'all discuss the fact that North and South Carolina's got the same debate going on?
Yeah.
Not
necessarily that particular thing, but
well, that's the biggest precedent in the Southeast. I mean, you got geodetic surveyors that have gone down into North and South Carolina, and they're sitting getting ready to tell people that think they live in North Carolina, you live in South Carolina now. We're sorry, but you do.
Cut their taxes being in South Carolina.
They're just going to draw the line the way they want to draw it, and geodetic surveys are behind it. And I mean, the precedents are just 99% out there for geodetic, and we went against it in Orange, now we're going against it in Guilford. And I think, you know, that side should have been put out there better than it was. Again, I say quorum's meet. You don't have a quorum met here and a non-quorum go over and meet. I just don't buy that when you know that they were going to possibly be able to vote, which they did.
Well, we weren't going over there to make a decision.
Well, I realize that.
Well, I mean, I think that's a fundamental difference, and you may recall I actually personally asked the commissioners about meeting with the board, and David Smith said there was no need for any more meetings, and you said that you didn't want to meet anymore.
I never said
that. I don't know. I said
go see the.
Well, I'll go back and listen to it. But, you know, I believed that when you went back over there, it was going to be committee to committee, and there's a difference. Committee to committee is one thing. Non-quorum with quorum is two different things. And I just wouldn't, you know, I would have had, I didn't have any idea that it was going to be a quorum over there and us sending over a non-quorum group. Now, maybe that don't mean something to some people, but it does mean a lot to me. And I'm sorry, I'm not going to belabor any further. I'm ready to vote, and I'm going to vote no on the resolution.
I'm ready to vote, too.
Well, the resolution, basically, Clyde, can you summarize the resolution? And we'll take this summary in the form of entertain the motion once you say it.
It establishes the procedure for requesting that the General Assembly of North Carolina change the location of the Alamance-Guilford line.
And is there a motion?
So moved.
Is there a second?
I'll second it.
All right, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
No.
No.
The vote is 3-2 carries. Thank you. Next item is the county manager's report, specifically a follow-up to this morning where we talked a little bit about present use value tax exemptions.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. One of the discussions we had this morning was proposed changes to the present use value, which is, sets a lower rate of about a 90% lower for those modified farms. What the General Assembly is looking at is basically four bills that would loosen those standards, so which would mean that more farms could be included, and then that means a loss of valuation and tax revenue to the county. Specifically, the changes are, right now they're going to add the managing of horses as part of the commercial grower for animals. So if you have a horse barn and you board a horse and you get over $1,000 a year for that boarding of that horse, that's now considered a commercial farming activity. You know, it's not cows or anything else, but if you're boarding horses, that can be now considered a commercial grower of animal. Also, there's a requirement that they're looking at taking out for tree management. Right now, if you're having a forest and you're saying this is a commercial forest, that you have to have a tree management plan that is approved. Now they're saying you don't have to have the tree management plan. So, you know, I could go out now and say, well, see that? That's my tree forest, you know, without a management plan in place. It's also changing from 10 acres of area that must be used to 5 acres. So again, it's getting not really more to the commercial, but more of a gentleman type farmer where it is. Currently, and this is from Jeremy, and Jeremy, please jump in if I'm saying something wrong. We have about 1/3 of all of parcels that are in the unincorporated areas of the county are in some type of present use value. And we have one auditor right now that goes through and makes sure that people meet the requirements as currently outlined by the General Assembly. If you make it easier to get in present use, you will have a lot more people taking advantage of that present use value. Therefore, we'll probably have to hire more auditors to ensure that the county is getting, you know, full value, and it's not somebody just trying to take advantage of the program. So we would look at that. Jeremy, probably would be okay this year, but next year about $150,000 in revenue could be lost if all these changes are made. Again, we would probably also look at hiring additional auditors to ensure that present use value, that the program is being fully complied with. And again, if you remember our meeting with the Farm Bureau, they had a lot of concern about present use value because there were people that were taking advantage of the program. And they, you know, are more concerned about the bona fide farmers not having that on their backs. They do have a concern about people taking advantage of the program who really should not be in the program. Jeremy, is that?
That's a very good summary of what's going on. You know, the concern that we would have the last 3 years, Craig Stanley, who's our present use appraiser, has been working very hard auditing and cleaning up the use program. Well, 90% of the people that have come out of the program have either not had sufficient acreage, well, that requirement would go away, they could come right back in, or they've not had management plans for forestry. And
forestry is very difficult to determine if it's valid or not unless there's a plan on file and we can check and make sure that they're following good standards, and that would be gutted. So many of the people that have just gone out of the program, if they reapply, will come right back into the program. And not only that, commercial concerns. The present use program was put in place to save the family farm. That's the issue. If you're Farmer Brown and you want to get in the program, it's built for you. If you're ABC Corporation, if you're Mega Bucks Corporation, that's not for you because it was for the family farm. Well, that's been completely gutted if this legislation goes through. And any investment group, any corporation can buy 20 plus acres, send us a piece of paper, and there's no way we can deny them that claim. It will reduce forestry's gets closer to 1/20th value than 1/10th. That's for agriculture about 1/10th. Forestry's about 1/20th.
Where is this coming from, Jeremy?
I don't know. There are multiple sponsors in both the House and the Senate. We've looked at the resumes of the individual. None of them are in the farm community. And I know that the farm community is upset about this. The discussions that had taken place in the last year was towards trying to lobby to increase the standards, to make it more rigorous, to get only serious, real farmers in the program. And this is the totally opposite direction.
Frank Bell brought this, as I mentioned this morning, at the budget retreat to our attention. And my understanding is that our local delegation has been notified about our concern and the board of ENR's concern. Have we heard back from any of them, Craig?
No, and one of the things that I was waiting on is, you know, make sure that in speaking for the board, that the board agrees with staff's recommendation that by changing the statutes right now, it really is going to loosen up the requirements and really give a lot of people a loophole to get in to. And again, it's going to devalue our property values, which will then devalue our taxes. You know, again, as Jeremy said, I think Craig, over the last 2 years, has found about $150,000.
Actually, in the past year, the situation with Craig is that it's a learning curve. So when he first came on board, it was a smaller amount, and every year has been ratcheting up. He's currently able to do about 1/12 audits. Now, the state requires 1/8. We're getting there. We're trying to get on track with that. At that level of auditing, which I think he's peaked, I really don't see him going much further than where he's at right now. He's actually returning back about $150,000 in rollouts and in monies that are perpetuated from back years. And this is a good thing. These are people that have not qualified for many, many years. Probably should have never been on the program. There was no auditing in place, no checking behind it. Well, I see that as not the main reason that he does that, but it's certainly a benefit to the county. This budget cycle, that wouldn't have any effect, but next year, that would all go away because the people he's pulling out would suddenly qualify. So that would go away immediately, and then it's just a matter of absorption. I don't know how quickly people would respond to come back into that program. It could be massive, it could be slow, but either way, it would be diminished revenue.
What's the County Commissioner Association?
The bills really came out on Friday. And we got notified on it on Friday. I sent a note to the Rebecca Troutman with the county commissioner, and this was staff's recommendation, and I said, this is awful. And then basically I got a response back yesterday, says we agree. So I believe the county association is going to be against these bills as well and against the changes. Again, the present use right now is a very liberal program as far as the requirements. And what it basically is doing is making it easier to get into the program. And it's like Jeremy said, there's truly people who deserve to be in the program, bona fide mom and pop farms, bona fide farms that do try to make a living off their land. But I think an argument would be somebody who boards one horse is not a bona fide farmer. You know, that's just something they do. And When you add managing horses as part of a commercial animal, you know, is that truly farming? You know, it's not cows, it's not goats, it's not chickens.
Craig, what two counties, or is it just two counties that are sponsoring that bill?
There's four or five different sponsors. Nathan Ramsey from Buncombe County. There's
two from Buncombe.
Right.
That's Asheville.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Jackson and Brock, senators. Representative Pittman, I'm not sure where he's from. Senator Jackson, Cook, and Tillman. Ramsey and Fisher with the House, I think they're both from Buncombe.
They're all for it.
They're all for it. But I guess what we would ask the board is maybe to send a letter to our delegation and signed by the chairman about our concern about loosening up the restrictions and about the additional cost. As Jeremy said, you know, we're a third of our properties that are not in the incorporated area is currently in present use now. So if we make it easier, then we're going to greatly erode also our tax base as well. So,
well, timing wise, is there time to construct a letter? I mean, I don't mind calling these guys.
We could do both. Email, yeah, board make a motion. We could, you know, say, you know, support the current, you know, present use value rules that are on the book, statutes, and discourage for making changes to the program.
Are the sponsors Democrat or Republicans or both?
I'm not sure. I do know some are Republican. I know Nathan Ramsey from Asheville. He used to be chairman of Buncombe County Board of Chairman for years. But it's just a concern that we do have. And again, if we do expand the program, we're going to have to hire additional auditors to make sure that people are meeting the requirements. Because Craig's maxed out now.
I didn't ask this because you may have already answered it. Just give me a raw example of a piece of property. I mean, how much percentage of decrease?
90%.
Of value?
Yes, sir.
Because of
present use. And I think
Gary. And more. Yeah, the land rates, if you're in agriculture, is going to be 417. I have to look to get the exact number. If you're in forestry, it's only just a little bit over $200 an acre. And so agriculture is about 1/10 value, forestry is about 1/20. Now, it's not an exemption, so that value doesn't immediately go away. What it does is it defers. And within 3 years, if that property is sold, if they cease that use, we do go back and recapture. But when it goes outside of the 3 years, we lose it. So we lose that income stream, and then anything past 3 years goes out of our recapture. Right now, we've got about revenue, not value. It's value of $385 million, revenue of about $2 million that are being deferred. With that pickup, who can say, with the requirement going down to 5 acres for agriculture, with the ability to regulate the forestry being removed, would that double? You know, would it take $2 million annually off in addition to what's already? I don't know. That's one of those crystal ball scenarios. I don't have that information, but it could be significant.
You talk to any other county managers about it?
Nobody yet other than the association, and it is definitely going to, they have a legislative update every Thursday as far as a conference call, and this is definitely on the agenda for that discussion. So,
let me ask you this thing. Can you find out from the county association the timing and when is this to pass?
Well, right now it's just being submitted, and I'm not sure of if it's just in committee right now, if it's getting out of committee, or if it's going to vote or not. Again, there's just a lot of bills that are introduced that never go anywhere. But one of the things, and I appreciate Jeremy and Gerald York as well, make us aware, is that we just wanted to be on top of this before it got down the road too far.
Well, I'll be happy tomorrow to call each of the three reps that we have.
Right.
Senator Gunn and the two House reps. Now, do we, and if that's all right with everybody, but what's the board want to do?
Well, I support the County Commissioner Association position on it, believe it or not, and I have to believe they've researched it better than we have.
Craig, you think if I contacted the Ag Committee too?
That would be a great place to go as well.
Yeah. I don't know when our next meeting is, because I don't, you know, we just have them every quarter, and but I can, Jason's not, he's not with the Ag Committee, but Todd still is.
If it never hurts, we'll send them a letter also.
Yes.
I'll see what I come up, I'm looking for it now.
Well, we wanted to make sure, before we started getting ultra-aggressive on this, that the board was aware of what we were doing and that we had your support, and that will help us as we move forward.
Yeah, I'll find out tomorrow and give them a call.
Is there any board member that's not in favor of us taking this position in reluctance or concern with the introduction of these four bills? All right, can you propose or draft a letter as well?
We'll get all that the first thing in the morning, yes, sir.
And I can sign that.
Yes, sir.
I'll call you guys and lady if anybody else wants to call them. That'll be fine as well. Okay, thank you. Do you have any other reports?
You made had a discussion about the budget public hearing, if the board wanted to.
Well, what we said this morning, what I said this morning was, I think we need to give thought for planning purposes. If county manager feels that it'd be better to have the public hearing earlier than later, my personal belief is we'll probably get more input in an evening meeting than a morning meeting just for that purpose. So I wanted to just throw out, is there consensus that we change the June 3rd meeting only to an evening meeting, which would include the formal public hearing on the budget in addition to any regular business we may have? Is that okay with everybody? Anybody?
As long as you'll make the second meeting in the morning.
You want to change it? Well,
we can do that. Yes, sir.
Okay. And last time we did that, we tried to hold off any other business so that we could focus pretty much on the budget hearing and let citizens speak as long as they needed to.
Do we want to have this at the courthouse?
Well, I think we need to have it somewhere other than here. Do you want to look into those options? But let's go ahead and at least get the time out there for people to know, and perhaps the media can pick it up.
Yes, sir.
And then we'll look at the courthouse or other places. Right.
If there's probably a motion to change that meeting time and place, and also that would set the public hearing for the budget.
And would also change then the following meeting, right?
Yes, sir.
Well, I'll ask David Smith if he'd be in a position to make that motion.
I'll make the
motion. I'll second.
Thank you. Thank you. Any other discussion on that? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries, and you'll work on
the
place.
Yes, sir.
Okay. We do have a brief closed session. This will be the last in a series of closed sessions. I'd like to outline what we're going to do and then read the motion. We have been working, the commissioners have been working with the direct reports, which include three positions in the county attorney, the county manager, and the county tax administrator. We've completed the process on both evaluation and goal setting for the county attorney and the county manager. The county tax administrator is new to the position, so we don't have a performance evaluation, but we do need to discuss goals for 2013 with Jeremy. That is the purpose of tonight's closed session. With that said, I move that we now go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute, Section 143-318-11A6, to consider the performance of an employee. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Bill. Any discussion about that? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? All right, we'll go in the conference room. Jeremy, if you'll join us.